Sturm-Liouville theory, or solving ODEs with orthogonal polynomials. So here are three books. Macquarie is a mathematical physics book. Nakahara is more in the direction of mathematics. And Conlon is a mathematics book. Some questions here, we won't really answer them. It's usually local versus global. So local means local analysis, local calculus. And global means how do you put stuff together? How does the boundary condition affect your result? Put your equations on an n torus for n variables. If you do this as simplification and it affects your result, is that a problem? Another question is it important to you to be able to take your intervals to infinity, either backwards or forwards? Or could you consider a compact space like the Riemann sphere? Do your vector fields, such as gradient, or if you're doing fluid dynamics, with flow velocities and so on, do they develop singularities or vortices? Or do you just have some finite clumps? That could be a resolution issue too. Just one thing, when I say topology here, I mean rough topology like Euler characteristic, or a finer topology like the Betti number, but more generally just boundary condition in this context. So the PDEs of mathematical physics fall in three classes: the wave equation with the wave speed c, the heat equation with the thermal coefficient alpha, and the Laplace equation, which is just lambda squared f. So they're called hyperbolic, parabolic, and elliptic, and they're classified by the signature quadratic form. Quadratic form in the sense of differential operator. So basically the relation between the time derivative and the space derivative here is different than the relation between the space derivatives and the time derivative, which is not here. And let's say this is the electric potential, follows from Maxwell's equations, that in the time-dependent static situation with no magnetic field, this will be the equation for the electric potential, the potential energy up to a constant. If we make an ansatz that u is just a function of radius times a function of angle theta, then we're assuming axial symmetry, no dependence on the last angle of spherical coordinates. Then we have a separation ansatz. We get this is one constant, and this has to be minus that constant. So we get two ODEs. One is this one equal to that, and one is this equal to this. This one is easy. The angular ODE looks like this. With this change of variables, x is cosine theta, we get this equation, which is the Legendre equation. So it turns out that to have a solution, lambda should be an integer times an integer plus one. This is explained on this Wikipedia page, but we'll get more into detail about this. But how do you impose boundary condition now if you have a solution? Here's a physical problem. Put the electrical potential on a perfect conductor to zero on this sphere, and at infinity demand that there's a homogeneous electric field. So this is the boundary condition for u at infinity, and this is a boundary condition at r equals a. So you think of two places, one is infinity and one is the surface, and you're imposing, in this case, Dirichlet boundary condition, you're setting the value at these two places. And now we impose these on this more generic solution. Here's one attempt to visualize it. It's not exactly accurate, you can figure out why, but basically, roughly speaking, the electric field points upwards as we had boundary conditions that it should at infinity, but close to the sphere, you'll be orthogonal to the sphere, which is the condition of being a perfect conductor. So the equipotential lines, the lines of constant potential, will be, for example, this circle here. I've picked some value here of y. In fluid mechanics, you can easily map this problem to fluid mechanics problem. You have similar discussion about flow lines, equipotential lines. This is just the simplest possible theory, which Feynman calls the flow of dry water. So this is not real fluid mechanics, but it's a good start for some exact analysis. Potential energy. What does that mean to a mathematician like Morse? Morse theory is about level sets, understanding topology by varying the energy and finding extrema. If you put a donut in a bucket and you pour in water, these would be the water lines for varying heights of water. By looking for extrema here, we could find where something interesting happens, such that there's a hole here. And this was discussed already by Maxwell when he talked about hills and dales in 1870. He tried to make a chart. Water can split little hills into disconnected islands when the water rises. So the topology influences your local analysis in a rough way, at least. In other words, the water can flow back and forth here how it wants to, but it has to obey certain properties that we can call topological. So here's a generic solution to the wave equation. Let's start with this and let it evolve. And what I did here was impose boundary conditions Dirichlet. And here's another starting point, and this is Dirichlet, so they bounce down when they hit the boundary. This is the one-dimensional wave equation. Here's an exact solution where I put a Neumann condition on the left boundary. Here's an exact solution. We had Dirichlet condition on both boundaries. So you should think of this as a string or a rope. Here's an example of dispersion. Here's a solution of the Bödecker's equation. Here's a solution with a little less viscosity, with very low viscosity. So you see the development of shock waves. So this is something you could worry about in a simulation. Anyway, what we had were these Legendre basis polynomials. They satisfy this equation, f equals pn, where pm and pn are orthogonal in the sense of integrating over this interval that was dictated by the physical problem. So is this generally true? This is a nice property. This means that if I take some function f, not just this specific one, but any function that's square integrable, I can span it in these functions And then I can extract coefficients by using orthogonality of the basis functions, just like I would in linear algebra. I can work them out in detail by solving this. And in fact, there's a generating function. There's an argument in electrostatics that there must be one. So taking this fairly simple function, expanding in T, you generate the explicit expression. So go ahead and try this. Of course, you're familiar with Fourier basis waves, that if you take a harmonic oscillator, I'm going to pick M to be integer, then my basis functions could be complex exponentials. They normalize such that they're orthonormal in the sense of the inner product on functions with this factor here. We can split them up to the real and imaginary part that you may not be more familiar with, but this is the simplest thing to manipulate. What about others? So we have two examples, Legendre and Fourier. This is Chebyshev in Swedish and German, other languages is spelled with a T, so they're called with a T, even though the English spelling is with a C. So they solve this equation. The generating function is this, and they satisfy this interesting property. So this equation generates lots of interesting trigonometric identities that are all pretty elementary. What about orthogonality of these polynomials? It turns out you have to multiply it by this if you want to show some kind of orthogonality property. So this weight function, this extra thing here, is less obvious than in the case of Fourier and Legendre, where there was nothing here. But it has other nice features. For example, the so-called discrete Fourier transform used in digital processing uses these polynomials. So this is the third example, and we'll see that there are many others. So one question is, can we take the interval to be the whole real axis? For example, what if we pick a different weight function? This is an equation of some interest. And this is the weight function. Yeah, by this I mean if m is not equal to n, then this is orthogonal. There's a relation between step operators in quantum mechanics and basic quantum mechanics and this. And these are also eigenfunctions of the Fourier transform. So there are many reasons to be interested in Hermite polynomials. They're relevant in quantum mechanics, Fourier transformations. But they have this funny weight function that I call omega here. So what's the general theory? I can actually orthogonalize any set of functions on any set of interval under some conditions. I can also normalize them. I didn't do that for the Legendre by convention, but I could. The interval that you should integrate over, like -1 to +1 for Legendre, is given by the problem. In the case of the Laplace equation on my sphere, it was because x was cosine theta, and I wanted the theta to go between plus and minus pi, so I get -1 to +1. But the question is, you find up with an ODE from separation of variables or from some other fancier technique, will it have an expansion in some orthogonal polynomials? And if so, what's the weight? This weight function omega just popped out of nowhere. How do we actually get it? Let's start with this question. So here's a simple example of Gram-Schmidt for functions that you might have seen before. You just define the inner product like this, in this case, and you see that these three functions are not orthogonal. X is orthogonal to 1. This is very abstractly meant, of course. As functions, they're orthogonal with this inner product. But x squared is not orthogonal, but you can fix that by subtracting some multiple of a lower function, 1, that multiple should be such that this vanishes. So this is the answer. So these functions, if this is shifted like that, are orthogonal. And now try to relate this to the Legendre polynomial discussion earlier. And this is the general framework. So Sturm-Liouville said, let's write an ODE on this form, where P and Q are functions, and F is the function we're interested in. Lambda is this constant, and omega could be a general function. You can package this in this form that L is a linear differential operator, and then LF is equal to minus because we move to the other side. So conventionally, sometimes this is plus. I'm going to put minus and then omega x here. So that means if I can write my ODE in this form, it's actually possible for any linear second order ODE, then I can extract the weight function just by staring at it. In general, I can allow mixed boundary conditions. These are the conditions you need to be reasonably confident that you will have a nice solution in the sense of physics. These should be continuous on this interval. This should be greater than zero, except possibly zero at the endpoint. And this should be zero at most at isolated points. Now, what does this mixed mean? I said if you set the value to zero, for example, that's a Dirichlet condition, and then you wouldn't have these. If you set the derivative to zero, for example, that's the Neumann condition, and then you wouldn't have these. What if you had a linear combination of them? What does that mean? In the sense of a string boundary condition, that means it's tilted at some angle at the boundary value. But it could have physical interpretations. For example, in solar cells, that's the surface recombination velocity, is the ratio between these two. So it can be more abstract than just some angle, but that's a good thing to have in mind. Notice here that lambda was not specified. Lambda is an unknown constant. We want to find lambda such that there are solutions. In the case of the Legendre polynomials, it was something like integers times integer plus one. So that's something you come up with at the end, roughly speaking, of this procedure. We classify them if P, that was this P here that I'd extract from a known ODE that I got from some physical problem. If the value of P at the endpoints are both non-zero, is regular, otherwise, it's called a singular Sturm-Liouville problem. And there are nice theorems about the regular case, but unfortunately, most cases in physics are singular and don't quite obey these theorems. But the theorems can still be somewhat useful. Here's an example of a typical argument in Sturm-Liouville theory. Take two possibly different basis functions, phi m and phi n. I use the same notation as I did for Fourier basis waves, but they could be anything right now. And now assume hermeticity, which is that this, where the linear operator act in here and then take an inner product, is equal to this, where I act with the linear operator here. In the literature, there's a slight subtlety between self-adjointness and hermeticity. Here by hermeticity, I'm going to mean this. My linear operator is going to be real, and P and Q are going to be real in the typical starting point. When I simply plug the equation in here, I get this condition, where now I included the weight function that was generated by this right-hand side. I included the weight function in the integral that I'm performing. By hermeticity of this operator, then eigenfunctions to a Sturm-Liouville problem with distinct eigenvalues are orthogonal. Meaning, if these are distinct, then because it's zero here, I gotta have this to be zero. I've at least sketched how, once you have a Hermitian linear operator, you have this nice property. Unless something funny happens, for example, eigenvalues are identical, then this is not guaranteed. And how do we go on from here? So we've sketched roughly what you can do with ODEs, but with explicit examples, we only looked at polynomials. Expanding a function in some set of orthogonal polynomials is a nice thing to think about. But what if it's not a polynomial? For example, in the case of the Laplace equation with axial symmetry, we got the radial functions were just some powers. The capital R from earlier just ends up being some power of r. In more interesting cases, like in cylindrical coordinates, you can get a more complicated function of the radius. That's called a Bessel function, and that falls in a general class that is related, at least, to Fuchsian ODEs. Fuchsian ODEs means only regular singular points. You can look that up if you don't know the definition. That covers many cases in physics. We allow complex solutions, then all with three regular singular points are called hypergeometric. So this is standard ODE, and Riemann tells you how to get to this standard ODE from a generic ODE with three regular single points, and put your regular single points at 0, 1, and infinity, and then you have an explicit expression for a solution. We'll talk more about this hypergeometric bucket in the next video.